Welcome to You Are From God, where we open the Bible and learn to see the image of God in ourselves and the people around us. I'm Scott Taylor.
And I'm Tyler Hall. Thanks for joining us today. Welcome back, and today we are going to be talking about self-deception. You know, Scott, when we talk about lying or being deceived or deceiving other people, a lot of times it's about looking at somebody across from you and trying to figure out what the truth is, or if you don't want the truth to be shown, covering that up in some way. But today we want to talk about what happens when that person is you and you're trying to keep the truth from yourself or denying the truth from yourself. And we can talk about any number of reasons why we would go into this, but the Bible has a thing or two to say about this. You know, that we can go to lots of verses where, especially in the New Testament, the Lord will instruct us, do not be deceived. And so a lot of that we can understand comes from false teachers and the idea that people are going to twist the gospel, and lots of different doctrines will have people swerve or stray from the truth. But there's a special segment of these scriptures we're going to talk about that specifically say, don't let you deceive you. Don't be deceiving yourself in these matters.
Yeah, that's the interesting part of this, is that it's one thing to deceive other people, and certainly that's something that people can do all the time. But there comes a point in time where you actually start deceiving yourself and so blind to what the truth is that you even begin to believe the lie. Mm-hmm. And 1 John, the first chapter, kind of talks about this. It's people that are trying to say they had a fellowship with God. They were walking in the light and they were sinning. And to the point in 1 John, the first chapter, beginning in verse 6, he says, if we say that we have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. So right off the bat, we're talking about, I can lie to other people. I can tell people I'm walking in the light, but really I'm walking in the darkness. I'm not practicing truth from that standpoint, but I can fool other people. He goes on and says, but if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us. So you get this next step, Tyler, that we're talking about, where I believe it so much because I've said it so much that I actually believe the lie. I believe that I've never sinned in context here. And there's other places. I always think of James, the first chapter, where he'll talk about those who hear the word, but those that don't do the word are deceiving themselves, that you think that you're doing the word, but really you just heard it. You're not actually living it. And then he goes on and talks about verse 9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. To the point where you've told other people this, you start believing it yourself, and then you even try to lie to God. You know, and God obviously knows the truth, but it's amazing, Tyler, how, to your point that you said earlier, how often the Bible talks about deceiving and how often those verses are talking about the fact I deceive myself into thinking that I can do these things. And it's very obvious and very clear that we cannot.
Right. That it's so powerful because even from the standpoint of, you know, an innocent deception, or you're not intending to lie to yourself or trying to force feed yourself a lie. It's even from the context of 1 John, it's okay, well, I'm a Christian now. I can't sin. There's no way I could possibly sin. No, you're going to stumble. And John's writing to Christians. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. And he gives us the awesome promise there in verses 9 and 10, the idea that when Christians stumble, it's not a practice, as John will go on to write about in chapter 3 of that letter, but when it does happen, it's a stumble that we get up, we repent, we confess our sins, we call the sin the same thing that God calls it. It's wrong, it's not who I am, and I'm turning away from it, I'm repenting of it. He's faithful and just to forgive us that. That is an awesome promise, but the deception comes in where we try to go back and taking, you know, God's grace for granted, or we just say, no, I can handle it on my own and stop trusting in God, when the reality is, that's the life we live. We are constantly, always, for everything, trusting in the Lord. You know, it's fascinating when you talk about just matters of salvation, but this comes down to just living everyday life. I'm looking through the scriptures, and in Jeremiah 37, there's another point that God warns people about deceiving themselves specifically. As we've already mentioned, Ephesians 5 was another place I thought of where, you know, don't let anyone deceive you because of all of these different things that he talks about in that chapter. The wrath of God is coming. Don't think God's going to turn a blind eye to this. Judgment demands wrath for sin. And so other people can certainly deceive you into thinking, oh, I don't have anything to worry about. But we can deceive ourselves. And Jeremiah 37 is a place where that actually comes up specifically. Jeremiah 37, I'll start in verse 6. The word of the Lord came to the prophet Jeremiah. This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. This is what you will say to Judah's king, who is sending you to inquire of me. Watch, Pharaoh's army, which has come out to help you, is going to return to its own land of Egypt. The Chaldeans will then return and fight against the city. They will capture it and burn it. This is what the Lord says. Don't deceive yourselves by saying, the Chaldeans will leave us for good, for they will not leave. Indeed, if you were to strike down the entire Chaldean army that is fighting with you, and there remained among them only the badly wounded man, each in his tent, they would get up and burn the city. So the idea here is that God has his punishment laid out, that the Chaldeans are going to come, the people of Israel are going to go into exile out of Jerusalem. But the people clearly in Jeremiah's day were saying, no, this is perfect. Egypt's here to help us fight. That when they go back, the Chaldeans aren't going to come back. And you can talk yourself into this place of, okay, we can just go about life as normal. It doesn't matter, or this doesn't have an impact, or that wasn't really God correcting me in that moment. And God, through this prophet here, is saying, don't deceive yourselves. Egypt's going to get out of the way, and then I'm absolutely sending them back. It's just so powerful, Scott, to realize that the hardest thing about this conversation is realizing it in ourselves. We can look at other people and say, oh, they're deceiving themselves. What if it's me that's deceiving myself? We literally have to sit down and take the metaphorical blinders off to really self-evaluate what's going on. And that can be a hard thing, especially when it means, as we've talked about on this program before, looking at the ways that I can improve, the things that I've been doing poorly or incorrectly, and striving to improve myself, but ultimately realizing that the way that I might protect myself, or in other words, trying to make myself feel okay with myself, is just lying about it. And that's not good for anybody, obviously me, but the relationship with God cannot function because, as 1 John already said, that means we're walking in darkness. We're not walking in that truth of the light that he is.
You know, it's interesting from that standpoint to think about justification or rationalizing the things that we do rather than seeing that we're the sinner. We're the ones that caused Jesus to have to die. I'm the one who shouted crucify, as a song we would sing. And you think about the reality of that and trying not to sugarcoat it or trying to make it where it's not that big of a deal, the things that we've done. Your sins are the reason why Jesus died. And I think about the Old Testament, David, when David and Bathsheba and Nathan tells them the story, and he's so mad. David is so mad at the story that's going on, and Nathan simply says, you're the man. Mm-hmm. You are the one I'm talking about. And the reality of that moment that we need to understand sometimes, we're the ones that crucified Jesus, and we've got to stop pretending like we're not sinners. We've got to understand that by the grace of God, we have the opportunity for salvation and living a life. I think about Judas. Judas obviously is the one that betrays Jesus, but early on in John, the 13th chapter, it's fascinating to me that Jesus washes his feet. Then after that, he's sitting there and he tells them, one of you are going to betray me. And he gives actually the piece of bread to Judas. And they're like, whoever I give this to is going to be the one. And then it says that the people saw that in verse 29, the other disciples, for some were assuming, since Judas kept the money box, that Jesus was saying to him, buy the things we need for the feast, or else that he was to give something to the poor. So after receiving the piece of bread, he left immediately, and it was night. They were as surprised as anybody else that it was Judas. Mm-hmm. He deceived everyone, including himself. And then he tried to lie to God. He knew full well what he was going to do, but he deceived himself into thinking that what the outcome of this situation was going to be. The other certainly didn't think that he was the one that was going to be betraying Jesus Christ. And you just think about that standpoint. The one that we look at and you think, how could you betray Jesus? Well, the reality is we can be Judas. Mm-hmm. That absolutely can be us. And we can deceive ourselves, we can deceive others, and we can try to deceive God. That certainly is never going to happen.
No, and just the power of our own minds. Obviously, God's given us our minds to do this, but it's not to be used in a way that's self-justification, self rationalization, self-righteousness. So, you know, you could easily see a situation perhaps in Judas's mind where he's rationalizing, well, you know, Jesus doesn't know how to handle money properly, which is odd coming from the understanding that you're talking about the Son of God. So there's obviously some blindness going on with Judas if that's the mentality anyway. But even from the idea of, well, I'm just going to get with the Pharisees. I'm just going to deliver Jesus over to him. They're going to make an example out of him. And then he's going to come back. You know, I'll have this money that I sold him for, but betrayed him for, and then we can use that to serve the poor. But we know from the scriptures that Judas actually just wants the money for himself.
Right.
And so even there's some self-deception, because mm-hmm. in that exchange where we read about in the Gospels, it's Judas saying, oh, we could have given that money to the poor from that broken alabaster flask. And the Bible, not Jesus in that moment will say it, but the Bible will narrate in that moment, but it's not that he wants to help the poor. It's he's in charge of the money bag. He loves money. And so he struggles with that. And not to say that it's wrong that he struggles. We can all struggle in different ways. But that is a place where he was weak, and so there was this self-deception that went along. Even in the scriptures, it'll say when Judas realizes the extent of what's happening, when he realizes Jesus isn't just going to be released, he's being taken to Pilate. Now he's going to the crucifixion row, so to speak. And Judas has realized this, and he tries to double back on it. He goes back to the chief priest and says, I made a mistake. Never mind. Okay, well, things are in motion. You see it. What's that concern to us? You see it to yourself. And ultimately, the sad ending of Judas's story is that he doesn't seek repentance like Peter does. He just ends his life. And it's such a powerful thing to understand how much our own internal conversations can go. We have the awesome opportunity to realize that God wants us to be honest with him and ourselves. You keep the conversation going over in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Context will start in verse 16, where Paul's instructing the Christians there, don't you yourselves know that you are God's temple and that the Spirit of God lives in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is holy, and that is what you are. Verse 18, let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you thinks he is wise in this age, let him become a fool so that he can become wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God, since it is written, he catches the wise in their craftiness. And again, the Lord knows the reasonings of the wise are futile. He goes on and talks about not boasting in human leaders, but boasting about being in Christ and having all these things in him. But the interesting piece here, as he's talking about them being this temple of God, is that don't deceive yourself. You know, look, you are the temple of God. What you do in your body matters. The things that you engage in, the things that you entertain in your thoughts, the practices you engage in, the conduct, the clothes that you wear, the things that you spend money on, the words that come out of your mouth, they all matter. It does not befit a child of God to do these things. And if you say, well, but I'm not really doing it for that, look, stop. You've deceived yourself. We can rationalize and give excuses for ourselves all the day long, but the reality here, as he says, you want to really conduct yourself in a way that's becoming of God, don't deceive yourself. Why don't you be wise? And not wise from the world standards, because that's going to lead to self-deception. This is wisdom that comes from God. The wisdom of the world is foolishness when it comes to looking at God's wisdom. And so for us, God, as we think about this, and as you're listening to this, listener, just consider just the gravity of what it is to be deceived by yourself. It can be one of the most subtle and quite frankly, one of the most damaging things that we can do. And so we constantly need to be vigilant about that so that we're not self-rationalizing or self-validating, but that we're going to God's word to understand this is what I'm supposed to do. This is the type of person that I'm called to be. This is what's truly pleasing to God. This is what matters to God. And seeking not to look for loopholes or excuses of why I can do what I want to do, but seeking to please him to the utmost in every single aspect of my life.
Yeah, I think about the Pharisees in the same situation, whether it's Luke the 18th chapter with the Pharisee looking down on the publican saying, well, at least I'm not like this guy, or they're thankful I'm not like this guy, or Jesus telling them in Luke 16, verse 15, you are the ones who justify yourselves in the sight of the people, but God knows your hearts, because that which is highly esteemed among people is detestable in the sight of God. And that's what we're trying not to be. We're trying to be people that, as you just said, children of God, and be the lights that we have been called to be in this world. And that's the key for us. Don't fool yourself. Make sure that you have that relationship with him, and never forget that we all have the opportunity to be from God.
Thanks for listening. Show your support by leaving a review on your podcast app and share this episode with someone you want to encourage. If you have questions or would like to get in touch with us, go to youarefromgod.com. That's youarefromgod.com.